We're all under surveillance, right? Your way to the static event could be traced thanks to the communication between your cell phones and the cell towers, your check-in at the railway station, or the scanning of your license plate. And on another day, when you're on the beach and you open a can of pop, an intelligence service using a satellite can look what's inside the can and whether it fits in with your diet. And when you start writing an email, an intelligence service, or maybe several of them, maybe reading your mail while you're still typing. This is the image we have nowadays of intelligence organizations. They have become secretive, almighty organizations, and we citizens have become their victims. They no longer restrict themselves to a couple of foreign spies and their domestic collaborators. No, even in our Western societies today, every citizen has become suspicious until proven innocent. We now live in a surveillance state, a national security state, or an intelligence state, and there's little we can do about it. This image is not only incomplete, it's also wrong. Intelligence today is no longer a one-way affair. If the government can surveil us, we can surveil the government. We can surveil the government and we can surveil other individuals. When it comes to intelligence, you are much more powerful than you may think. Intelligence is something that is, can, or should be done by you. And this will have tremendous consequences for the type of society we will live in, starting from now. Around 1950, several Western European intelligence and security agencies suggested to their governments that they should have a monopoly on the gathering and use of intelligence, comparable to the monopoly the armed forces and the police had on the use of violence. Today, such a monopoly on the use of intelligence would be unthinkable. Intelligence organizations, for instance, outsource their activities to private firms because, for instance, they don't have the command of all languages of the so-called terrorism belt stretching from West Africa to Southeast Asia, or because they are no longer at the leading edge of technological know-how. And today, it's no longer only the government organizations that carry the words security or intelligence in their name that execute intelligence activities. No, it's done by a host of government organizations, such as the tax authorities, customs, or even municipalities in their social control functions. But this loss of the near monopoly on intelligence goes even further than that. Intelligence is done by individuals like you and me. Imagine we would be able to resurrect someone from the dead who died 15 to 20 years ago. And we would tell this person, we are going to describe something, give you some clues, and then you have to guess what we are talking about. And we would say, we are talking about something that uses passwords or codes. It uses one or more false identities. It uses encryption. It may use satellite imagery. And it takes counter-surveillance measures. Now, that recently resurrected person would probably tell us that we were talking about a secret agent or an intelligence service. However, the activities I just described are today done not only by intelligence organizations and their employees, but by billions of people, including you and me. When we start using our computer, our phone, our iPad, we use a password. When we start a game of word feud, we may decide to use a false identity. When we start messaging on, for instance, WhatsApp, We use encryption, even if we don't know it. When we look for maps or street views, we may use satellite imagery. And when we receive a message that we do not immediately trust, we have found ways of detecting deceit or fraud. We are on our alert for being hacked or for receiving phishing mail. And if we want to buy a certain item, we may decide not to use our credit card this time. Or when we want to look up some information on the internet, we may decide not to use Google this time from our own computer, but instead look it up in an internet cafe or in the library. Now, all these activities could be called counter-surveillance measures. So yes, intelligence is public and private nowadays. Let me give you another example. Imagine your partner tells you that the neighbors just bought a new home in a posh neighborhood, and you want to find out what they paid for it. Now, you no longer have to call the real estate agent with an excuse to find it out, or to wait until the sale has been registered with the cadastre. No, today you can go to the National Real Estate Agent's website and find out what price was asked for the house. And if you think, well, that's a rather expensive house for my neighbors, and they have rather expensive cars as well, you may call in the number of their license plate, and in real time you will get the current value of their cars. And if you think, well, the combined value of their cars and their new home doesn't square with their incomes, you may inform the authorities, especially if you saw your neighbors loading one of their expensive cars recently with something that looked like washing powder, but may actually have been something else. Now, you may tell me this is intelligence, all right, but this is not the type of intelligence that is done by intelligence agencies. Let me then give you a few examples of people who actually did the work of intelligence agencies. After 9/11, the terrorist attacks on the United States in 21, several American housewives, such as Shannon Rossmiller, decided to track down jihadists on their own and actually caught some of them behind bars for 30 years or more. Or think of the Dutch high school kid who mapped the changing front lines in the Syria conflict on a daily basis using social media messages, which he verified and validated, and thus got himself a position with the BBC. But it could just have been a position with any intelligence or security service. Or think of the British blogger who established where American photographer James Foley was beheaded by Islamic State by using the background in the beheading video in combination with Google Maps. Or think of the private initiative Bellingcat, which attributed the responsibility for the shooting down of Malaysian Airlines flight MH17 by looking into social media messages, including selfies that were posted by soldiers belonging to the units that were involved. Or Open Briefing, the world's first civil society intelligence organization, which drew up the order of battle of the Russian airborne forces after stories broke out of little green men invading Crimea. And finally, the so-called Panama Papers, the electronic equivalent of 650 million pages that were collected and analyzed by the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. Now, all these activities could have been done by you, me, your brother, your sister, your father, your mother, your neighbor, your friend, your colleague. And all these individuals have major advantages over the official organizations. They are inexpensive, they are not rule-bound, they don't have the command and control problems of the official intelligence organizations, they are not subject to oversight, and they are not hindered by national boundaries. So think of someone who looks up some information on the Syria conflict on the internet, and after a while he decides that it may be interesting to enter a chat room and to have a talk with some of his fellow countrymen who left for Syria as foreign fighters. Nobody is going to stop him from doing so. If, however, an employee of an official intelligence organization in the West would like to do the same, it would take days or maybe even weeks to get the official permission to go ahead. And the same would apply if that individual would like to share his recently gained insights with somebody in a foreign country. So, yes, intelligence organizations, they seem almighty, but they run the same risk from individual activities as the Encyclopedia Britannica ran from the individuals that make up Wikipedia. They run the risk of being outpaced and undersold, and in the end, they may become obsolete. At the time of the Cold War, intelligence organizations in the West had privileged access to information about the inner workings of the Kremlin. But today, only a very, very small percentage of the information they use is actually secret. A lot of it can be found by using so-called open source intelligence, which you can find on the internet or in a library, also you and me. Or we can hack into the Internet of Things, where your television set, your car, or your running app communicate, for instance, with their manufacturer. Everything that has the word smart in front of it today, whether it's your refrigerator, your office, or an entire city, is a tremendous intelligence platform and can be hacked. Or we can use drones to do our spying, as the organization People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals did, trying to record illegal hunting. And we have a lot of academic institutes who have set up their own databases on foreign fighters in Syria, and sometimes find higher numbers than the official national intelligence organizations did. So, yes, we are living in the age of the amateur, who is more fit and more adaptive than the official organizations and their professionals. And this outcompeting of intelligence organizations by individuals might well be future scenario number one. There's another scenario. Scenario number two. These intelligence organizations might be clever enough to understand the risk they're running and decide to use and encapsulate the individual intelligence activities. In the United States, the intelligence community already does quite a bit of crowdsourcing, asking the public to predict certain developments. There are even competitions to find out who are the best predictors and analysts. And it turns out that a certain percentage of them does a better job than the agency's analyst. And sometimes such information from the public comes about more or less spontaneously, as was the case when people started detecting the perpetrators of the so-called Boston Marathon bombings by going through the pictures of the crowds looking for people who were carrying backpacks. And of course, authorities might also solicit this type of information, as the police already sometimes does. However, and that's scenario number three, there are certain risks involved in engaging the public in intelligence activities, especially when it comes to collection. You may turn your society into a nation of informers, as was the case at the time of Nazi Germany or East Germany at the time of the Stasi. before you know it, everybody becomes an informer. And although these informers may have the best of intentions and try to protect us from terrorists, certain parts of their information will contain false positives, with all the consequences this may entail for the people about whom they inform, such as people who are removed from a plane just because they read or speak Arabic. And then there's scenario number four. Maybe not everybody likes to be engaged in the official intelligence activities, and instead of helping the authorities out, they would like to obstruct their activities. This is what we call surveillance, the exact opposite of surveillance. It happened, for instance, on the so-called day we fight back, 11 February 2014, when cameras surveilled the parking lot of the NSA and made the pictures available on the internet. Or in spring 2015, Transparency Toolkit made a database available on the internet containing the resumes of 27,000 people working in the US intelligence community. And they were collected from the online social network LinkedIn. And finally, there is the fifth scenario, where individuals may decide to start spying on each other, completely independent from the government, and thus creating the type of society that was described by the 17th century political philosopher Thomas Hobbes, where due to a failing government, man becomes a wolf to another man. It may sound noble when Anonymous uses its powers against Islamic State, but what if the same powers were used against you? And this idea of, in principle, every citizen spying on, in principle, every other citizen becomes rather scary, especially since hacking will no longer be restricted to only computers or laptops, but will also be directed against medical devices such as pacemakers, or even our brain when it becomes connected with computers via interfaces. I hope I have shown you that the individualization or privatization of intelligence is already well underway, and that this will have tremendous consequences for society and for you. Intelligence is no longer only public and private, it's also political. Knowledge is power, and much depends on what will be done with that power. And the outcome will decide whether we will be living in a totalitarian, an authoritarian, an anarchic, or a democratic society. And since it will be you who will be doing the intelligence and decide what to do with it, much depends on you. So please, do not turn our communities into totalitarian or Hobbesian societies. Thank you.